Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we're going to begin our discussion on the muscles of the upper limb. As always, we're going to start proximally and move our way distally. So our first set of muscles that we're going to discuss are those axioappendicular muscles. So those muscles that will have some form of attachment on the thorax in addition to either the pectoral girdle or the shoulder or the humerus. And then lastly, we'll talk about those short intrinsic shoulder muscles. So you can see that our major muscles are going to be pec major, pectoralis minor, serratus anterior, our shoulder cap muscle, the deltoid, and lastly, the rotator cuff muscles. So again, just a reminder of what we mean by axioappendicular muscles. These are going to have their muscle bellies on the thorax, meaning that they'll have a proximal attachment on the thorax. And then those distal insertions or attachments will either be on the scapula or the humerus. And dependent on whether it is attached on the scapula or the humerus means that either only moving the scapula, or this means that this could be moving the shoulder joint. So we'll talk about those major muscles as well. They can also play a role in terms of moving portions of the thorax as well, in terms of a reverse action motion. Okay, so let's start with the big one, pectoralis major. And this is kind of in the breast region, so just deep to the breast. You will have two heads. You will have the clavicular head, which you can see right here. And you can see it attaching on that clavicle. And then you have the larger, more fan-shaped sternocostal head. And just kind of working through where this attaches proximally, you have the sternum and costal cartilages. And then both of these heads will kind of come together in a common tendon to attach on the humerus, meaning that this muscle will directly affect the shoulder joint in terms of its actions. And so when both heads are contracting, both the clavicular and the sternocostal, this will play a role in terms of adduction, or moving that shoulder or the arm back towards the midline, as well as medial rotation. So think of this anterior portion of the arm medially rotating. But interestingly, when the two different heads contract independently, they can be antagonistic to one another. So that clavicular head, if it's contracting by itself, will cause the arm to flex, meaning think of the arm moving anteriorly, whereas the sternocostal head, when it contracts by itself or independently, it can extend the shoulder, particularly from that flex position. So it is cool that we have one muscle that can be antagonistic to itself, depending on what fibers are going to attack or what fibers are contracting. We'll have another muscle like that that we'll talk about in this video. Deep to the pectoralis major. So here's pectoralis major that has been reflected. You will have the pectoralis minor. And as its name would suggest, it will be minor or smaller to the pectoralis major. You cannot see pec minor until pec major has been reflected. It will have a distal attachment on the coracoid process, as you can see here, of the scapula, which means that it does not cross the shoulder joint, so it will only affect the actions of the scapula. And it will play a role in terms of protraction of the scapula as well, and we'll talk about what that action is in a moment. But really, kind of the main role of pectoralis minor is to stabilize the scapula, meaning not really allowing the scapula to move, to allow the shoulder joint to really do some more purposeful movements, because the scapula is kind of stuck in place. The last axioappendicular muscle we're going to discuss is the serratus anterior, and it is named due to its kind of sawtooth appearance. So you'll have these little slips of muscles attaching on the ribs, and then it will have an attachment to the anterior portion of the scapula, kind of that medial border as well. And this is a pretty powerful muscle. It will cause protraction of the scapula, because it is not crossing this shoulder joint. It is going to directly affect the scapular movements. In protraction, you kind of think of moving the scapula, particularly that medial border of the scapula, away from midline. All right, so think of kind of when you put your arm out in front of you, or if you kind of punch right out in front of you anteriorly, that scapula is going to move away from the midline. A lot of times you'll hear this muscle referred to as the boxer's muscle because they're going to utilize it so much in order to get this kind of forceful kind of punching movement. Now, there's something unique about the serratus anterior that I really want to make sure that we understand. When we're talking about neurovascular bundles and the innervation of muscles, typically the nerve that will innervate the muscle will enter the muscle kind of deep to the muscular belly. All right, so almost every neurovascular bundle you will see will be coming in deep to the muscle, and that plays a role in terms of added protection to that neurovascular bundle. Now, what is unique about the serratus anterior and its innervation is that its muscle or its nerve, the long thoracic nerve, will enter and innervate the muscle superficially. So here's the serratus anterior. You can kind of think it would be like right about here running down this region. So that is very unique in terms of how that innervation is organized in comparison to the muscle belly. And you can kind of think about if you had some type of injury, say some type of like stabbing right to the side right there, or some type of surgery in this region, maybe to remove some lymph nodes, you could directly affect and kind of nick that long thoracic nerve as it's so superficial right there. And that is referred to as paralysis of the serratus anterior, but more commonly you will hear this referred to as a winged scapula, because supposedly that scapula will look kind of like wings. And you can see this medial border of the scapula on the injured side will kind of move posterolaterally and kind of project, and really it will project posteriorly. And so it'll become much more obvious than on the other side. And so really, this is most commonly caused by injury to that long thoracic nerve, which will lead to paralysis or weakening of the serratus anterior. Okay, now moving into the intrinsic shoulder muscles. These tend to be short, and they are going to have their proximal attachments on the scapula, and they will have their distal attachments on the humerus, so meaning that they will cross the glenohumeral joint and play a big role in terms of movements of the glenohumeral joint, and also, very importantly, stability of the glenohumeral joint. So we'll start with the big one, the deltoid. The deltoid is the shoulder cap muscle. If you think of the muscle that's sitting right on top of your shoulder, that is the deltoid. It is a big muscle. It is a very robust muscle. The fibers are very robust in this region. And it's going to have three different parts. You'll have the clavicular part, the acromial part, and the spinal part. Sometimes you hear these as anterior, middle, and posterior, but it really is kind of giving you an idea of their basic organizations of how they're organized. And this is kind of similar to what you had in the pectoralis major, where dependent on which fibers are contracting, you can have very different movements that occur, and they can be antagonistic to one another. So you can have flexion and extension. So flexion would be that clavicular, extension would be the spinal, contracting independently. Same thing with medial and lateral rotation. Now, I'm not going to have you memorize which fibers cause which action, like I did with pec major, just because there's a lot more actions here. But I do want you to note that dependent on which fibers are contracting, this muscle can be antagonistic to itself. So it can flex, extend, it can medial and laterally rotate, but really kind of the money action when we're talking about the deltoid muscle, and typically its most powerful action, will be abduction. And so a lot of times you hear that this acromial part will play the biggest role in abduction, but all three parts are really contracting for abduction to occur. So abduction is really moving that arm or moving the shoulder joint away from the midline. And this muscle is going to be innervated by the axillary nerve, which is one of the terminal branches of the brachial plexus. So that axillary nerve, if you recall, is going to move around the surgical neck of the humerus. So if you have a fracture to that surgical neck, you could directly affect the axillary nerve, which would affect these actions we're just talking about. Okay, and then deep to the deltoid muscle, you will have the rotator cuff muscles. And we talked about the rotator cuff muscles when we were talking about the shoulder joint or the glenohumeral joint, as these muscles are extremely important in terms of the stability of the glenohumeral joint. So it'll form that almost complete cuff around the shoulder joint. And so really, we're going to talk about some of the separate movements that these muscles will play a role in. But when you talk about all four of them together, really one of the major functions of these four muscles are to help stabilize and keep the head of the humerus articulated with the glenoid fossa. There are four in all rotator cuff muscles, but there are three rotator cuff muscles that are going to be located posterior on the scapula in terms of their proximal attachments. You will have the supraspinatus, which is above the spine of the scapula, the infraspinatus, and the teres minor right here. So these are three of the four rotator cuff muscles. All three of these muscles will have their distal attachment on the greater tubercle of the humerus. And that's why the greater tubercle is greater than the lesser tubercle, because it has three muscles attaching there rather than the one. There are going to be different actions that are associated with these muscles. The supraspinatus, or that most superior one, will help initiate abduction of the shoulder. So about that first 15 degrees of the action of abduction is going to be caused by the contraction of supraspinatus, and then from there, deltoid muscle takes over. The infraspinatus and teres minor are going to be very important lateral rotators of the shoulder. So kind of thinking of moving that anterior portion laterally. And then lastly, the fourth rotator cuff muscle is the subscapularis, and this is the only one that will be located anterior on the scapula. So it's a rather large muscle. So this is the anterior surface of the scapula, just deep to the subscapularis. And you can see it's pretty much taking up almost all of the space right here. And it will have its distal attachment on the lesser tubercle. And it will be a very powerful medial rotator of the shoulder. Okay, so that should cover us in terms of the muscles. But before we leave, I can't not talk about rotator cuff injuries, because you've probably heard of rotator cuff injuries. You may have known somebody who had a rotator cuff injury. You may have heard it in terms of some type of a sporting event. And what this is kind of a complex of many, many different types of things that can occur. But what is going to be most common is some type of tear or rupture or damage to that musculotendinous rotator cuff. So that portion of the tendinous portion that is going to attach and surround the shoulder joint underneath here. And anytime that you have any type of injury or weakening of this rotator cuff, this is going to be a cause of increased instability of the glenohumeral joint, because recall that rotator cuff is so important in terms of the stability. The most commonly injured or damaged will be the tendon of the supraspinatus. And really, I would have this tendon a little bit further over here. I think this is showing the muscle belly a little too long, because really that tendon can rub up against, with increased friction, the acromioclavicular joint region or these bony portions, particularly if the arm is abducted or flexed, you know, fully. Think about abducting your arm above your head, you know, thinking of that particular type of movement, you could see that tendon could feasibly pinch or kind of rub up against the bones in this region, making this tendon one of the most commonly injured. Recall also that we had a bursa up there, that subacromial or subdeltoid bursa, and so that inflammation in that region of that bursa, or any of the bursa in these regions, could lead to bursitis or pain associated with the rotator cuff general regions. So not an uncommon thing that occurs. This can happen due to overuse of this region, say like in an athlete, a pitcher could be more susceptible to this type of injury. But also with increased age, oftentimes you will hear rotator cuff injury frequencies increasing as well. Okay, so that should finish us in terms of the muscles that we are going to discuss in the axioappendicular region, as well as those intrinsic shoulder muscles. So one fairly important area I want to make sure we review. So damage to the axillary nerve may affect all of the following actions, except which of the following? So kind of keys here are going to be axillary nerve is damaged, and we're looking at separate types of actions. And so all of these are shoulder joint. So that should be helpful in terms of, okay, we need to be thinking shoulder joint region. And you need to think about which muscles are going to be innervated by the axillary nerve. Now, the teres minor is also innervated by the axillary nerve. I'm not going to have you memorize that one. And teres minor, as you recall, is going to be important in terms of lateral rotation. That's not on here, so no worries there. What's the other major muscle that is innervated by the axillary nerve? Hopefully you recall the shoulder cap muscle, or your deltoid muscle, is going to be innervated by the axillary nerve. So we've got that part down. We kind of had a second order question. We needed to know what the axillary nerve innervated, so we know the deltoid. Now we need to understand what are the actions of the deltoid muscle. And recall that the deltoid muscle, depending on which muscle fibers are contracting, can do quite a bit. Abduction is definitely one of the major actions of the deltoid. So this is not right. Adduction, I don't really remember that one quite as much. And then remember that depending on which muscle fibers are contracting, there's a lot of actions that could occur that are antagonistic. So flexion and extension are feasible. Medial and lateral rotation are also possible with contraction of the deltoid muscle. So it's really this adduction of the shoulder joint, which is basically the only action that the deltoid muscle will not play a role in. So adduction is going to be the correct answer here. Okay, so make sure that you review these muscles and kind of the major things that we reviewed in the lecture. If it's not covered in the lecture, it's not that it's not important, it's just not going to be something that you need to make sure you recall for the assessment. Thanks for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.